We are live.
Good evening, everyone. Welcome to iFocus Online, Lecture 130 and Glaucoma Session 34. And today we have with us Dr. Arvind Neel and for the International Keynote Lecture on Neurosurgical Procedures for Glaucoma. I request Dr. Vanita to please introduce her.
Thank you, Rolika. It's a great pleasure to introduce a friend, a confidant, Dr. Arvind Neelakantan. He likes to be called Dr. Neel, and I think he is called Dr. Neel where he's practicing in Dallas. He's an American board certified ophthalmologist and glaucoma specialist. He currently is serving as a physician and CEO at the Glaucoma Center of Texas in Dallas, Texas, USA, of course, and also holds the title of Associate Professor, Clinical Ophthalmology at the University of Texas Southwestern Medical School, also in Dallas. He received his medical degree in 1989 from erstwhile University of Bombay, Mumbai, of course, now that it is known. And since then, he has completed several ophthalmology residencies, actually. First at the University of Bombay, followed by a University of Glasgow in Scotland, as well as University of Florida, Gainesville. He's extensively trained in glaucoma, having completed several clinical fellowships, the last one being at Bascom-Palmer in Miami, Florida. He's also done it at Moorfields Eye Hospital, London, England, as well as at Shankar Nethralaya, Chennai, India, of course. In addition, he completed a two-year postdoctoral glaucoma research fellowship at the University of Florida in Gainesville. He has received an achievement award by the American Academy of Ophthalmology in 2014 and has also been honored as a fellow in glaucoma surgery by the International Society of Glaucoma Surgery in 2020. He is also a fellow of the Royal College of Ophthalmologists, London, England, and Royal College of Surgeons of Edinburgh in Scotland. He's fairly widely published in peer-reviewed journals and has, in addition, authored three glaucoma textbook chapters. He has presented at talks at various international meetings and tends to be have a regular appearance at our Glaucoma Society of India annual conferences. With these words, I will actually pass on to Dr. Neel. Please be advised that he is actually working this morning, and we have recorded his talk, and he will come live within as soon as the talk ends, hopefully in 50 minutes from now. So I'm sharing the screen where we have recorded his talk for today, which is on newer surgical procedures in glaucoma.
Hello, good morning. From Dallas, Texas, in the United States. I guess it's about 8 o'clock in the evening for you all in India. Thank you for being here to listen to me talking. I'd like to thank Vanita for this kind invitation to talk about newer surgical procedures for glaucoma. As you're aware, today incisional glaucoma surgery includes a plethora of surgeries, and I'd like to divide it into three distinct categories. The first one would be to improve the existing drainage system, and that's where the mixed category comes in, mixed standing for minimally invasive glaucoma surgery. The second category I like to use is where we create a whole new drainage system. And we've been doing this for a number of years with trabeculectomy being the gold standard. Some express shunts came along, and now over the last 10 years, the glaucoma drainage tube implants have gotten very popular. But off late, you also have some subconjunctival mix, but I like to call it licks, because you still have to use mitomycin C for these to work. And I think mitomycin should not be taken lightly. Hence, I call these less invasive glaucoma surgeries. That include two categories, the Zen gel stent and the PreserFlo or the microshunt, which is also called the iFocus microshunt. Let us not forget, we also very frequently reduce the amount of aqueous production, which helps with glaucoma management. And the cycloablative procedures that are in common vogue today are usually the diode laser. I think most places have given up on using the cryotherapy, or at least I hope so, because that's definitely blinding if the disease itself is not blinding. If you have access to the ECP, that's good. You can do direct visualization of the ciliary process and treat them. If you don't, then the external G probe and the more recent micropulse variation with the MP3 probe. Going back to MIGS, and that's going to be the main focus of my talk today. Again, MIGS standing for minimally invasive glaucoma surgery. I think there are some people also call it microinvasive glaucoma surgery, but I think we have settled right now on MIGS standing for minimally invasive glaucoma surgery. I like to separate this into two distinct categories. One where there's an indwelling device, or you place no device at all and just work with stripping the trabecular mesh. In the device category, the most common ones are the iStent first generation, the second generation iStent inject, and the Hydrus microstent. There was a supraciliary stent, the CyPass stent, that is no longer in the market, and we'll talk about it down the road. In the trabecular meshwork stripping devices, the Cahoot dual blade goniotomy is exceedingly popular right now. And so are the gonioscopy-assisted transfemoral trabeculotomy, or the GAD procedure, and its variations like the ABIC and the OMNI. The trabectum was a standalone device with a standalone irrigation aspiration system. In fact, I think the trabectum was the first mix that came into vogue nearly 15 years ago when I started practicing in the United States, and was established by Don Minker. But since the trabectum also has come up with a handheld device called the Trabex. So with this background in picture about various incisional glaucoma surgeries, let's go ahead and talk about MIGS. So why is MIGS so popular? This is a neoprene injection by Ashton, presented way back in 1951, showing very, very clearly how the Schlemm's canal drains into approximately 30 collector channels. And then the collector channels go on and go into the aqueous veins eventually. The big problem we have with MIGS and the collector channel system right now is we don't have a reliable method to evaluate the collector channels. So if one of these is atrophic, if we get into the collector channel system or into Schlemm's canal, is it going to work? We don't know. So it's kind of a hit and miss, and we try and reach as many collector channels as we can. So bleb-free glaucoma surgery involves enhancing the patient's own drainage system. It does not involve the conjunctiva, it's conjunctiva sparing, or it involves minimal conjunctival manipulation, leaving the conjunctiva open for future filtering surgeries if need be. But why MIGS? Because blebs, we've done blebs for many, many years. Trabeculectomy has been a standalone procedure, and we know the problems that come with onset of delayed onset endophthalmitis, and the unslightly blebs that are sometimes formed. But we do blebs because that's what really lowers intraocular pressure into the range that we want for advanced glaucoma. But there's a large percentage of glaucoma patients out there that are called glaucoma light that really don't need low pressures and do really well with mid-teens pressures. MIGS or blebless glaucoma procedures typically lower this intraocular pressure into the mid-teens with possibly need for one postoperative medication. They work well with phacoemulsification. In fact, you can perform these procedures with the same temporal clear-coronal incision that you use for phacoemulsification. And again, like we said before, if this procedure does fail, you can still go ahead and perform traditional glaucoma surgery under the conjunctiva, either a trabeculectomy or a glaucoma drainage tube implant. So what are the three major outflow targets? You can target Schlemm's canal, you can target the subconjunctival space, or the supraciliary space. Let's talk briefly about the supraciliary space. Like I alluded to earlier, the CyPass device by Alcon was released about 6 to 7 years ago. It was FDA approved in one of the most elegant clinical trials called the COMPASS trial. However, on post-study data and review after 5 to 7 years, they found there was significant endothelial cell loss in patients who had the CyPass implanted, and hence the FDA, they recommended to the FDA to remove it from the market, and the CyPass was recalled. Glaucose is an iStent Supra that's currently awaiting FDA approval, and it'll be interesting to see how and what recommendations they come out with. I have, just to make it clear, I have at least about 25 to 30 patients with CyPass in my practice, and I monitor endothelial cell counts, and I think they still look pretty good. So there is a current feeling among the glaucoma community that some of this may have been because of poorly placed shunts and really not because of the CyPass implant per se. So let's leave that alone for the moment and come back to Schlemm's canal. Like I said, again, Schlemm's canal, you can divide into two distinct categories, devices and no devices. iStent, the iStent inject wide and the hydrus, the Cahook dual blade goniotomy, the GAT, viscodilation, omni, trabectrum. So there are multiple devices you can pick and choose. And I think it's for the surgeon to make himself comfortable with one or two of these procedures so that he can pick and choose for a particular procedure for his particular patient. And we talk about customized glaucoma surgery. The ones in red are ones I'm going to be talking about today. The ones in black, I'm really not going to address. But if you want to ask me questions in the question answer session later, I would be happy to address that issue. Among the subconjunctival space devices, I shall talk to you about the Zen gel stent today. So this is a nice cartoon showing you where the various devices go in the eye in the anterior chamber. So the first is Zen gel stent, and we said that's a subconjunctival device, transmitting aqueous from the anterior chamber into the subconjunctival space. It's a collagen implant. The hydrus is a titanium scaffold. It occupies a big area of the trabectal meshwork. It's not rounded, and the scaffold has got three windows. The iStent inject, on the other hand, is a collar stud that just goes right in. That's the second generation. The first generation is a snorkel. And this is the CyPass that was recalled that got fluid into this potential suprachoroidal space. Going ahead, another caricature showing you the GAT of the ABIC procedure where a suture or a catheter is threaded for 360 degrees of Schlemm's canal and then pulled through ripping trabecular meshwork for a full 360 degrees. If you don't want to do that, you can use a trabectrum or a GAT or a Cahook dual blade, either of which just strip trabecular meshwork in the nasal anterior chamber angle. All mixed procedures are performed in the nasal anterior chamber angle because that is the angle that is amenable for us from the temporal approach. So let's talk about the Glaucos iStent. The Glaucos iStent was one of the first generation mixed procedures, came out about 2012 in the United States, in a snorkel-like design, 1 millimeter into 0.3 millimeters. It was the smallest device known to be implanted in man. The implanted ab internal into Schlemm's canal, again sitting temporally into nasal anterior chamber angle. It is approved for use in conjunction with thought cataract surgery in the United States, so we could not do it as a standalone. You had to do it in conjunction with cataract surgery. This is a registration trial by which the FDA approved it. It was a randomized evaluation of the trabecular bypass stent with phaco emulsification. So either patients got phaco with iStent or they got phaco alone. And these are the two bars down below that show you the results. The first graph shows you a maintenance of intraocular pressure under 21 millimeters of mercury. And the second one is intraocular pressure reduction of greater than 20% from baseline. The black bars are the ones with phaco iStent. The white bars are phaco alone. And across the board, the phaco iStent won over the phaco alone. But to me, one of the take-home messages from this study and to a lot of ophthalmologists has been that even phaco alone does reduce the intraocular pressure to a good extent, nearly 50%, okay, at 12 months. Not, it's about 76% in the phaco plus iStent, but 50% reduction in intraocular pressure, 50% of patients at less than 21 millimeters of mercury reduction in intraocular pressure, that's pretty impressive. So if you carry on this data to 2 years, and this is a Randy Craven paper, it showed that the iStent maintained excellent clinical results to complete of 2 years. And again, the blue lines are the phaco iStent, the black line is phaco alone. And you can see at about 2 years, the lines are diversing a little bit with the phaco alone group, the pressure starting to go up. And that has been our clinical experience as well. And if you look at the ocular hypertension treatment study that looked at intraocular pressure lowering with phaco alone, I think they came to the same conclusion. Anyway, with the phaco iStent group at 2 years, they achieved a 33% reduction in the post-washout mean IOP and an 81% reduction in the number of mean medications. Pretty impressive at 2 years. There's a feeling that if you use multiple iStents, you can target more collector channels and helps you can reduce intraocular pressure even better, maybe into the lower teens, targeting advanced glaucoma. This is a paper from Ike Ahmed's group from Canada, in which 28 patients had implantation with 2 stents and 25 patients had implantation of 3 stents. 83% of the eyes had a decrease in topical ocular hypertensive medication in 1 year. The 3-stent group was in significantly lower medications, 0.4, than the 2-stent group, which had 1 medication at 1 year. So it seemed to suggest that more stents you put in lower the intraocular pressure. So based on this, the company worked on a second generation and came up with the iStent Inject second generation device. Again, these are titanium devices with a heparin coating. They're collar stent implants that are placed directly into trabecular meshwork on a direct gonioscopic control. So this is the introducer, ergonomic design. There's a sleeve that covers it and just the button you press to implant the iStents in. So both stents is a targeted delivery. You're trying to hit more aqueous channels. The theory being that one aqueous collector vein drains aqueous fluid at 1 microliter per minute. Whereas if you target 2, you should come to at or near epistolar venous pressure because aqueous is formed at a rate of about 2 to 3 microliters per minute. What you're looking for is areas where there's blood and Schlemm's canal or there's increased segmental TM pigmentation because those may be the areas where the collectors are more active. And you want to space these 2 collar stent implants approximately 2 clock hours apart. So the iStent Inject introducer has a trocar with a sleeve around it. It's very important that you position the trocar right in the middle. You penetrate the tissue of the trocar, that's the trabecular meshwork. You lightly dimple the trabecular meshwork and push on the plunger, and boom, you implant the stud in. So these are the 2 studs very nicely implanted in a trabecular meshwork. It's very important that you have very good gonioscopic visualization of the angle. Now, I did not talk about this a little bit, but all mixed procedures are done from a temporal clear corneal approach, mostly, other than the subconjunctival ones. You have to rotate the patient's head towards their other shoulder. The microscope has to be able to tilt, and the newer versions of most ophthalmic microscopes, now you can tilt them. So you tilt it so that the oculus comes down 45 degrees down to yourself. The patient's head is to the other side. You place a little viscoelastic on the cornea. You use a, what is called a modified Swan-Jacob gonioscopy lens to visualize the nasal anterior chamber angle. So you get a direct view into the angle. It's not an indirect view. So that's useful so that you're placing it. It's not across, it's not opposite. You don't have to think of the left versus the right or the top or the bottom. It's a direct view of the angle. Now, once it's placed beautifully into TM, believe me, I've seen these devices being placed in spur, in ciliary body, and so many other places. So I think it's really important for the devices to be placed where they're meant to be placed if you want them to work. So this is a little video of the iStent Inject, which is from my colleague. Now, what I really like about this is that if you look, the TM is nicely pigmented. See, those nice first cases. If you ever want to start doing MIGS, this is a beautiful case because you can actually see the trabecular meshwork really, really well. So that you can see, this is the Swan-Jacob gonioscopic lens. It's a direct view. That's the introducer to the clear corneal channel. That's the trocar that she's trying to dimple right there. Intratrabecular meshwork, she's dimpling, she's trying to deliver it. And she's having a little bit of difficulty sometimes. But you can see there's a little plume to tell you that that's the right access. You got to the right point. She places that and then she turns 2 clock hours apart. And again, she tries to place the second stent. Now, what is important to notice, she probably has tried to implant it in here previously, was unsuccessful, she came away. That's what that blood is. And here, whom knows, she implants it and you can see the collar stud. And once she's happy with the placement, she takes it off. And then you can always use a little viscoelastic or balance salt solution to wash away the blood and make sure that the implant is sitting properly like she's doing right there. Okay, let's move on to the next slide. So some of the other studies that are being done right now is to put an elutable drug within these implants so that the patient doesn't have to use drugs postoperatively. So a lot of work going on with delivery systems, and they're essentially trying to use the glaucose iStent as a delivery system. This is called glaucose iDose, in which they put travoprost. And they had a phase two trial with 154 patients, and they compared both fast and slow eluting, and the other the control arm is patients on topical timolol alone. And they seem to feel that the iDose achieves an intraocular pressure reduction about 30% at 12 months. It's still phase three ongoing, and I'm sure you're going to see a little bit more about this as time goes on. Anyways, I just wanted to give you a brief insight as to what some of the other stuff going on, where these implants are going to lead on to. Let's talk about the big boy, the high-risk microstent. Now, this is really a big piece of metal, but it's one of the thinnest and most malleable metals, made of flexible nickel titanium alloy. The whole implant is 8 millimeters long. Now, it's non-luminal in the sense that it doesn't have a lumen. It's not completely closed. It's more a scaffold design. It's got three windows in them. It's long. It's crescent shaped. Again, you implant an ab internum from a temporal clicoronal approach. And you sometimes don't go to the phaco incision. You make a separate paracentesis incision about a clock hour apart just to get better access into trabecular meshwork. It's got a trimodal mechanism of action. You can see here, it occupies nearly a quadrant of the circumferential trabecular meshwork. So it's a big implant right in there. So the trimodal mechanism of action right here is, first is you bypass trabecular meshwork into Schlemm's canal. That's where the fluid goes in through. You have these three windows that are dilating Schlemm's canal. And you can see this is Murray Jolster's beautiful histopathological slide showing you the scaffolding and how it dilates Schlemm's canal. And then it covers about 90% quadrant of the trabecular meshwork, really allowing egress of aqueous bypassing through into meshwork. Now, there have been some talk of if this doesn't work, people are trying to do eczema laser trabeculoplasty or trabecular ostomy, if you want. Ostomy is the right word, actually. After you put the hydrus in, and if you think they're blocked, people are trying eczema laser. None of this is approved. A lot of this is still very experimental. I thought I'll just mention as to where things are leading on to right now. So the Horizon study was the study by which the hydrus implant was FDA approved. It was a prospective multi-center randomized controlled trial that compared phaco alone, 187 patients, to phaco plus hydrus, 369 patients. It was a 1-in-3 randomization schedule. Patients with mild to moderate glaucoma were recruited. And essentially, you looked at reduction of intraocular pressure and use of glaucoma medications after 24 months. And the consensus was that the intraocular pressure reduction with hydrus was far superior to phaco alone, and hence the implant was brought onto the market. So if you look at some of the data, this is the, let's go back to that, sorry. This is the 12-month data, this is 24-month data, and this is the absolute drop in intraocular pressure. The blue bars are hydrus microstent, the gray bars are phaco alone. So the difference in intraocular pressure at 12 months between the phaco alone and the hydrus is about 15.9%. It grows to 19.5% at 2 years. Again, the absolute reduction in intraocular pressure is about 8.5 with the hydrus at 12 months and about 7.6 at 24 months. Again, statistically significant difference between hydrus group and phaco alone at both 12 months and 24 months. This is a video of implantation of the hydrus. I must tell you, it's courtesy of Ike. I don't know, Ike is speaking on this, so I'm going to put the volume up and maybe you can hear him a little bit, but I'll also help you explain.
The hydrus microstent is implanted into the eye using an ab internal clear corneal approach. The incision is made to the right to allow for the curvature of the cannula, which you can see is uniquely curved to follow the curvature of the angle.
So this is what I was talking to you about earlier, where you finish the phaco muscleification, and most times you go through the same phaco incision, but because of this curve is very acute and you want to get into trabecular meshwork, you may want to make a separate incision a little away from the main wound to allow the to get the hydrus microstent in.
As you see in its position, the distal tip of the cannula is used to incise the inner wall initially. Only about 100 microns of that distal tip will actually enter the canal. You'll see that there is some torquing of the eye, which is expected, some positive pressure onto the canal to allow penetration. But once this occurs, we will relax our hands slightly and advance the roller wheel to place the device into the canal. Notice how the device is slightly placed in an upward fashion to ensure we have adequate passage. And at this point now, we relax our hand, releasing the tension against the outer wall and allowing the implant to be smoothly directed into the canal. The site interlock releases the inlet from the implantation device, and the cannula is then withdrawn. And we'll now take a look and see the device in its position here. As you see the inlet to the right and the three windows to the left, there's normal blood reflux in this case. In fact, it actually helped us to visualize the canal position prior to implantation. And we will now evaluate the position of the device using a Sinsky hook just to manipulate the eye. Notice as the eye is torqued down, you can see three windows nicely positioned within the canal, which is where we expect it to be. You'll see the blood reflux behind those three windows present in the canal, scaffolding the inner wall nicely and keeping the canal open. The inlet is into the anterior chamber very slightly, and you see the transition zone is where the incision has been made into the inner wall.
All right. Thank you, Ike, for so nice.
The Hydrus Micro.
So this is a recent publication in ophthalmology, which compared to two mixed devices, right? So, you know, we all ask the question, now, what do I implant? Do I do an iStent inject, or do I put a Hydrus? How do I pick and choose, and with patient, what I do? So this was a prospective multi-center randomized trial comparing the Hydrus and the iStent injects in patients with glaucoma for standalone treatment. So this was done up, this couldn't done in the US, this was done outside the United States, comparing standalone Hydrus versus the iStent inject. And again, it was a one-year study looking at efficacy reducing intraocular pressure medications. 452 patients were enrolled. The intraocular pressure was at baseline about 23 to 29 millimeters of mercury after washout. So without medications, and usually the pressure is about 24 at least before you can get into the trial. So Hydrus had a much greater complete surgical success. There was much greater reduced medication use at 12 months. So if you look at the zero medication use at 12 months in the Hydrus group, there were nearly 50% of patients who didn't have medications, as opposed to just a quarter of patients with the iStent inject. So I think that was a significant difference between the two. And again, if you look at patients that needed more than three medications at 12 months, you know, a lot more were within the iStent inject group as compared to the Hydrus group. So this was a big selling point for the Hydrus or the iStent inject, in whom you would pick and in what implant you would pick in which particular patient. Two patients needed secondary glaucoma surgery in the iStent inject group, and the Hydrus group, nobody needed further glaucoma surgery, and this was out to about 1 year. There was a greater change in intraocular pressure from pre-op, as well as a decrease in medications in the Hydrus group, as we talked about. Like the change in the Hydrus from pre-op was about 1.7 plus or minus 4, whereas the iStent inject really got a millimeter difference between the two. So the difference was nearly a 0.7 millimeter difference that was statistically significant. Again, medications, like we said, a lot many more Hydrus patients were medication-free at 12 months. So now we're going to go to the realm of trabecular meshwork stripping procedures now that we've finished three devices. And I'd like to talk about the GAT procedure first. GAT standing for gonioscopy-assisted transluminal trabeculotomy. This is this caricature here. I'm going to put my picture down here. If you actually look, you can see very clearly, you know, you're trying to thread this little thing all across Schlemm's canal and pull it through. So essentially what you're doing is you're opening Schlemm's canal into anterior chamber for about a total of 360 degrees. No more trabecular meshwork, take it off. It's minimally invasive, purely transcorneal procedure, okay? It requires good clarity. You require a good view into the anterior chamber angle. We started off doing this procedure using the microcatheter from iCat, the 250 micron catheter. Now, I know a lot of people in India don't have access to this, but we all have access to a proline suture. The six-year prolapse suture can be, the tip can be blunted with the help of a low-temp cautery, and you can glide that into Schlemm's canal. And because the prolapse suture is pigmented blue, you can see it as it passes through trabecular meshing. However, your operating room or operating theater needs to have microsurgical instrumentation to be able to fiddle with all of this intra in the anterior chamber angle. So you need to have really fine micro scissors and micro forceps before you can attempt doing this procedure. Let's go here. That's the video now. Let's look at this. So the eye is filled with viscoelastic, and I've threaded the microcatheter in. We take a 25 gauge MVR blade, again, through the cornea into the anterior chamber. In a direct gonioscopy visualization, you're making a little goniotomy incision, slitting open the trabecular meshwork so you have some access into Schlemm's canal. You want to be generous with this. You don't want to finch with this. And this is the micro forceps now feeding the microcatheter into the nasal anterior chamber. Feed it very, very slowly. Now, as you feed it, it's traversing through Schlemm's canal, and you're looking for the lighted beacon tip where it ends up. And you can see it's already come here. So traverse all the way through, it's back up here. So you put your gonioscopic lens back on, and very soon you'll see the lighted beacon tip is going to reappear. It's up here, you can see the sclera, and it's going to reappear here in the angle. So you now know that your catheter has traversed Schlemm's canal. Sorry about that. Fingers, let's pull this up here. So let's go. Okay, so you can see it's going to come back again. There. And once it traverses back, you catch either end, essentially, and pull it, pull through. So the catheter breaks through a strip through trabecular meshwork, and you're creating a cleft into Schlemm's canal directly. There's no more trabecular meshwork. Very easy. You fill the anterior chamber with viscoelastic. Very often at this juncture, you'll see a good reflux of a lot of blood at the anterior chamber angle. And then what you do is you use automated irrigation aspiration or a bimanual technique to wash out all the viscoelastic as well as the heme in the anterior chamber angle. If there's persistent bleeding, you can put your patient to a little reverse Fredericksburg position and leave a little fill of heel on the anterior chamber, and it's going to be okay. Don't fill it completely, about a 20% fill, so that there's some tamponading of the reflex blood into the anterior chamber angle. So if you look at a two-year follow-up in 198 patients, essentially if you divide patients into secondary glaucoma and patients with primary open-angle glaucoma, in open-angle glaucoma patients at 24 months, the absolute decrease in pressure was about 9.2 millimeters of mercury and about a reduction in 1.5 medications. We had even a more decrease in intraocular pressure in secondary glaucoma eyes, about 14.1 millimeter drop and medication reduction of 2. The cumulative proportion of failure in this paper ranged in a wide range from 0.18 to 0.48. There's transient hyphema, 30% was the most common complication, and we talked about that as I discussed the previous slide. In this systematic review and meta-analysis of treating open-angle glaucoma with a GAT procedure, 10 studies were included and reviewed. They found that the mean intraocular pressure decrease was 9.81 millimeters of mercury. The number of medications were reduced by about 1.68. The surgical success was pretty high at 85%. The re-op rate was about 20%, 1 in 5. So I think that's a little bit on the higher side. So I actually talked to my patients before this and say, especially if they have moderate to severe glaucoma, I would tell them, I try to do this in a lot of younger patients that have not had glaucoma for a long time. And I think the canal procedure works a little bit better for them as opposed to a 70 or 80 year old glaucoma patient who has been using drops for so many years. And I think the angle is a little sclerotic at that point. So I tell them that if it doesn't work, you know, then they could get a trabeculectomy or a tube or something, which is external filtration. And so it's nice to prepare your patient for this kind of an adventure before. The hyphema rate is about 36%, but or like we said before, it spares the conjunctiva. So it's safe and effective, minimally invasive glaucoma surgery. You can always proceed with the trabeculectomy if you need to. Let's talk about the Kahook blade. Malik Kahook designed this. He put his name to it. It's called the Kahook dual blade. You know, why it's important is because you've been doing goniotomy for a number of years, congenital glaucoma, and I think a lot of you in this audience may have done that. You used a 25 gauge needle to do that. As you saw in the previous video that I showed you with the GAD procedure, we have used a MVR blade. The problem with that is the two leaflets, once you can fuse back together and the canal can recanalize. So what the Kahoot dual blade aims to do is take away a whole strip of trabecular meshwork, so that way there's not enough tissue to recanalize. The sharp tip of the Kahoot pierces trabecular meshwork really well. There's a little ramp here that elevates and brings forward the trabecular meshwork. And then if you glide the Kahoot blade within, the two dual blades there strip the meshwork as you glide along. And the foot plate or the heel here, it prevents damage to the anterior wall of the canal. It's important to come forward and stretch the meshwork anteriorly or direct it parallel to the meshwork, as opposed to going toward the back wall of Schlemm's, where you can hit the black wall of Schlemm's and then the Kahoot blade really doesn't traverse very smoothly across. But again, that's a technique that comes with use, as anything else is a learning curve to all of these. So that's a video of me performing a Kahoot blade. Actually, this is one of my first cases that I did again. Nice pigmented trabecular meshwork. I always, if they want to start mixed procedures, these are good eyes to start them on, because visualization is good, you know where you are. You can see so nicely, pierces the trabecular meshwork. Okay, it strips the overlying canal. I like to take away all that, I call it a little, stuff sitting on the top right there. Now, once you're happy with the cleft that you've created to one side, you very, very gently now try and rotate the blade towards the other side. As you'll see, I'm going to be doing that. And then you'll traverse the blade in the opposite direction, again, creating a cleft. I like to do as much meshwork as I can see. I like to treat as much meshwork as I can see. So sometimes I'll go to one side or the other side, and I'll rotate a little bit as to get as much meshwork as possible to try and just, you know, improve the success rate. There's a theory out there that more meshwork you treat, probably the intraocular pressure getting a little bit lower, because you have more access to more collector channels. So going on from there, so let's look at some studies with the Kahoot dual blade, okay? Before we do that, I want to show you this little beautiful gonioscopic picture of showing what a cleft looks like postoperatively with the stripped off trabecular meshwork. You see the back wall of Schlemm's canal very nice. In a GAD, if you actually do this a year or so later, you'll find that sometimes the inferior angle is closed off because the iris creeps in there and you had some blood. And remember, iris likes to creep into these open spaces that you've created, especially early postoperatively. So I keep my patients on pilocarpine actually for a couple of weeks after these kind of procedures, just to draw the iris away from the cleft. Greenwood studied these patients for 6 months, and starting at at about 17 millimeters of mercury, there was about a 4.6 millimeter reduction to about 12 millimeters of mercury at about 6 months. And the mean drop in use of medications was about 0.7, 0.75. That's pretty reasonable. Still, there are a retrospective analysis of 42 patients, and 24 patients, 22 eyes of 24 patients. The pre-op mean IOP was 25.5. The pre-op mean medication use was 2.3. Now, what I want to point out is these are eyes with angle closure glaucoma. A lot of the mixed procedures are all based for primary open angle glaucoma, and the angle has to be open. And you really cannot perform those procedures, especially the ones with devices, in patients with angle closure with a significant PAS, because these devices can be occluded by the iris processes. So goniotomy is a really nice procedure, because even if you have PAS, you can always do a little goniosynucleolysis along with the Kahoot grill blade, pull the iris off there, and then perform the goniotomy into the Schlemm's canal. So when Cyril looked at this, he found that at 12 months, the intraocular pressure was markedly reduced to 13.3, starting at 25.5, and the mean reduction in medication use was from 2.3 to nearly 0.14. So you actually reduced your medications by 2.2. 93% of patients in the study achieved intraocular pressure under 18, and about 100% achieved a greater than 20% reduction in intraocular pressure. Pretty impressive results, in my opinion. In this study, looking at phaco Kahoot versus phaco iStent, again, a prospective randomized clinical trial by Falcon Berry. This is published in the Journal of Cataract and Refractive Surgery. 164 eyes, 164 patients were studied. They found that both procedures lowered rocket pressure. Both procedures reduced the need for postoperative glaucoma medications. However, the Kahuk blade eyes achieved target IOP of greater than 20% reduction or greater than one medication reduction in month 12, significantly in more eyes than in patients with the iStent inject alone. And this has also been my personal experience. If I have to have a patient whose pressure is running at 30 or high pressures, want to bring it down on every medicine, and I think the glaucoma is not very bad, then I actually go in for the Kahuk dual blade. Whereas if I have a patient whose glaucoma is pretty well controlled in a couple of medications, they have a cataract that needs to come out, then I think with at least in the United States or some of the Western countries, we try to offer these iStents and devices in a way to reduce the burden of postoperative medications, given all the current data that we have. So the problem, again, as we said before, is when we offer these procedures, is we don't know what the actual status of the patient's, individual patient's collector channel system is. If everything is great, everything flows through and you're going to have success, or if you have atrophic collectors, atrophic channels, any place to stand, things are not going to go anywhere and the intraocular pressure is still going to be high. So one of the misadvantages of MIGS, you may say, is they say it adds cost to the health system, and we still don't know, we're still trying to figure this out. But every device costs money. Every, you know, the Kahuk dual blade is a single use blade, you open it, costs money. In a country like India, or developing countries, or India is no longer a developing country, but I think, you know, cost matters in a big way because patients got to pay out of pocket or whatever it is. So this is a cost comparison study of three mixed procedures, the trabectrum, the iStent, and the ECP versus glaucoma medications in Canada, where they were able to pull some data and they did some statistical mathematical modeling as to what they thought the cumulative cost difference could be in Canadian dollars. They looked at patients with one drug, two drugs, and three drugs versus these three. Now, these negative numbers mean that medications are cheaper. The positive numbers mean that the stents were better or the mixed procedures were better. And you can see when you first start off in the beginning years, medication use would probably be cheaper. But the longer the devices stay in or the longer that you go with these mixed procedures, there seems to be an advantage in the medication reduction use over a period of time, and hence you're saving money to the health system and cost. So this is something you want to keep in mind as we bring these procedures into our surgical armamentarium for treatment of our glaucoma patients. So that being said, I'm going to move on to the subconjunctival mixed procedures. Again, I don't like to call it mixed, I call it LIGS, because we have to use adjunctive myomycin with these patients in order for these procedures to work. They're again conduits, which are essentially transferring the aqueous from the anterior chamber to the subconjunctival space. The Zen fortifies a collagen implant, we're going to talk about that. The pressor flow is a little cannula made from stuff like cardiac cath cannulas. It's like a fin ray thing that you create a scleral tunnel and insert it. I don't have surgical experience with it as it is still not FDA approved. It is CE marked and people in Europe have been using it successfully and actually South America as well with some good surgical success rates. Within there. Santyl is the one that has been marketing worldwide. It used to be called the InFocus MicroShunt, but in the United States, they're going to call it Pressor Flow. We're still awaiting FDA approval. I think because of COVID, things have been pushed back quite a bit as well. So the Zen 45, why 45? Because the inner collagen diameter is, the inner lumen is 45 diameters, 45 microns. There was another one called 65, but I think you'd remember, these are not guarded filtration. Once you insert it, the aqueous is going to percolate by capillary perfusion using the Poiseuille's law based on the length of the tube and the lumen. And the length is about 6 millimeters, the inner diameter 45, and that is found to be optimal for the reduction of intraocular pressure. When the Zen 45 was approved in the United States, it was approved for ab internal incision, wherein you go from inside the anterior chamber out into the subconjunctival space and you place the collagen stent. And this is a very nice anterior segment ultrasound showing you the lumen in the anterior chamber, the intrascleral path of the collagen wick, and it's lying in the subconjunctival space. This is a gonioscopic photograph showing an end-on view of the Zen stent. This is the introducer. It's a 27 gauge needle introducer. That's the plunger that when you push it down, the stent is deployed. And here's the little stent lying in the subconjunctival space right here. So at 12 months, this was a study based on which it was approved in the FDA, approved it in the United States. 65 patients underwent this. For some reason, they got away without doing a randomized controlled trial with trabeculectomy. I think that is in the works, and we still have to see some of the data. They were followed for 12 months. At 12 months, 75% reported a greater than equal to 20% intraoperative pressure lowering. The mean change in IOP is impressive, about 9.1 millimeters. The mean change in medication was 3.5 to 1.7. So minimally invasive, you're just doing one little puncture into the, you know, the conjunctiva. It's minimally conjunctival manipulation, but you are using mitomycin. And the range of mitomycin is varied. I tend to use 400 micrograms or 0.4 milligram per mitomycin is my go-to for these procedures. This is the baseline that started up here. You can see fairly good reduction in intraoperative pressure at about 9.1 in about 12 months. The downside is it's a very high needling rate. Why? When you approach it ab interno, you're trying to place it subconjunctival. Very often the lumen is in the subtenon space and get plugged by the tenon. So you have to needle on the table or in the slit lamp, you have to move the tenons away. It's a 30 to 45% rate of needling with the ab interno lesion. It's difficult to predict. So based on that, a Canadian ophthalmologist and later on the United States, a lot of us started doing an ab external approach where we now put implant, the Zen implant from outside in. It has some advantages, a much quicker procedure. Again, you're just using a smaller territory of the conjunctiva. There's more conjunctiva available in the future if you have to perform a trabeculectomy or go back in there. Unfortunately, we don't have any studies with the ab externo approaches yet, but I'm sure that's going to be ongoing, as a fair number of us in the United States are actually performing this procedure as an ab externo off-label procedure right now. So this is a video of me performing the puncture from the outside to the in the ab externo. You mark 3 millimeters of the limbus, 7 millimeters of the limbus. The needle introduced at the 27 gauge is placed in the subconjunctival space at the 7 millimeter mark, tangentially rotating the conjunctiva, come to the 3 millimeter mark. At this 3 millimeter mark, what we did is we go intrascleral and we pass the needle intrasclerally for 3 millimeters. I like to use a traction suture that I can pull the eye down and can infraduct the eye. So as I pass this intrasclerally, I wait for it to come into the clear corneal area. Once I know it's reached cornea, I pull the suture up, as you can see, and dip the needle into the anterior chamber. I have to visualize the anterior chamber, the needle. Once I visualize the needle in the anterior chamber, I deploy this, the Zen. And you can, my focus right now is in the anterior chamber, and that's why I moved the microscope down, because I want to see the Zen as it entering the anterior chamber. I'm sorry, it's not really visible on this video. But what you will see in this video as I now pull the introducer back is aqueous into the subconjunctival space. Presto, and there's a really nice bleb right on table, right then and there, and I withdrew the needle introducer. I use a mirror gonioscopy on the table to visualize the Zen implant. That's the end-on Zen implant. I'm going to show that back to you again. That's important for you to see. And there's the Zen implant right there, the end-on you coming right through. I like to place a millimeter or two in the anterior chamber, and the rest is intrascleral, about three, and the rest is the subconjunctival space. I inject mitomycin C at this juncture. I inject a concentration of 0.4 milligram per mil. I inject a total volume of 0.1 cc. I'll let it diffuse over the anterior bulbar conjunctiva. I try to make sure my needle is placed in the subtenon place so that I don't get too much avascularity of the conjunctiva. And actually, I wash out the excess MMC on the conjunctival cul-de-sac with an eye wash. So that's just a needle puncture of the conjunctiva right there. We have more recently moved to an opening, like an open view. So we open like you open a phonics-based flap for a trabeculectomy. You just have to open about 2 clock hours. I use mitomycin sponges or an injection, whatever works. I like to use a wide diffuse application of mitomycin sponges, as you can see in this. I try to place the sponges for a total of 3 minutes duration. I then mark 2 millimeters from the posterior limbus, because that's going to be my intrascleral track of the Zen implant. I place the needle introducer in there. I slowly tunnel it towards the cornea again, pulling the traction suture up. I dip it in the anterior chamber. And now I push on the plunger of the Zen implant as I deploy. And you can probably see the Zen as it was coming off right there. And as the Zen is deployed, the needle introducer actually retracts back into the introducer. You got to be careful that it doesn't flick, but sometimes you move laterally and flick, and the Zen is very, very flimsy and flick away. So there you can see aqueous flowing in subperitoneal space right now, and that's the Zen implant lying on the surface. Again, gonioscopy to show, you know, where it is placed in the anterior chamber, about a millimeter, millimeter two. And here you can see the Zen placed on the top. You can see the egress of fluid from the Zen implant after I refill the anterior chamber with balanced oxidation. So that's good flow on the table. You know the stent is picked. Now this way you're able to control where this external lumen lies under the tenons. You drape the tenons of the conjunctiva back over back to the limbus and secure on the two wings which are the inner side. I also use a horizontal mattress. So you're able to actually absolutely place the lumen where you want it to be. More control as opposed to using an ab internal technique where you come from inside out. That's elegant, but many a time you get stuck in the tenons and doesn't work very well. So why use this over a trabeculectomy? Trabeculectomy offers more titration, but I find it's a much quicker procedure. You can perform this in about 15 minutes as opposed to it takes about 25 to 30 minutes to perform a trabeculectomy. Again, post-operative care is much faster because, you know, there's no cutting stitches, there's no releasable sutures, you're able to manage the bleb a little bit better. And again, the bleb management is like you manage any trabeculectomy bleb. You'll add steroids and take off steroids as be. And I think our needling rate overall has decreased to about 1 in 5 patients from 1 in 4 to 1 in 3 patients in the past. And a lot of patients seem to do well with the Zen procedure. So in conclusion, after all these procedures that I've shown you, the goal for us as glaucoma surgeons remains to lower intraocular pressure in the safest manner possible so as to achieve some management of glaucoma and to stop optic nerve deterioration. If monotherapy fails or the patient's intolerant to medications, it may be time to start talking surgery because you know patients on multiple medications don't do very well. What I like about MIGS is that it offers better surgical opportunities to patients earlier on the disease. We don't want to wait for later on the disease to form a trabeculectomy or a tube implant. You're able to customize the glaucoma treatment to a patient. I would use the devices if I want to get them off medications. I'd use the trabecular meshwork stripping procedure if I really wanted a good reduction in proper pressure. However, if the patient had advanced disease, threatening fixation, big scleromas, I am not hesitant to perform a trabeculectomy or a tube, and I do a lot of those as well in my clinical practice. So it's also important to consider, along with cataract surgery, adding on a glaucoma procedure now, because we consider us good anterior segment surgeons, and it really helps patients come off medications and achieve a better control of intraocular pressure. So like I said, if a patient needs a very low intraocular pressure to prevent blindness, and I think it's worth the risk of filtration surgery like a tube implant or a bleb, and with its associated problems with life of a lifetime and needing lifetime bleb vigilance. However, many patients do quite well with postoperative medical IOP in their mid-teens on one medication, and that is certainly achievable with some of these newer technologies, the minimally invasive glaucoma surgery. That's a whole umbrella bracket that we use for these procedures. So that's one takeaway that you take from this talk today is that you should probably think about considering angle surgery for your adult open angle glaucoma patients. I know that the GAT procedure has been performed in India and there's people who can teach it to you. And I'm sure some of the other devices are going to come into the market not so very soon. Thank you so much for your time. And I'd be happy to answer any questions as we go along. It's been a real pleasure. I'm sorry you had to stay up so late to watch me tonight, but I truly enjoyed giving you this talk and I'm happy to contribute and take any questions.
Thank you so much, Neil. That was a mind-boggling array of all the MIGS all put together. I'm sure, there are a lot of questions, but at this point I will invite chair and co-chair to share their impression.
Thank you, Vanita, and thank you, Neil. That was absolutely wonderful. I think it was great for our students to go through every, and this so beautifully and meticulously you explained each and every procedure and the pluses and the minuses. And obviously the problem with Indian market is that some of these things came, but they are so expensive that it becomes a little tough for us to actually practice them, at least in the corporate sector. Maybe in the government sector where the things are free, they may be able to do it more often. And yes, I definitely would like to ask you that Even in angle closure glaucoma patients, once you have done the cataract, the chambers deepen up, and I think most of these things could be done there as well. Neil, what do you think about that? You are muted, I think.
I am muted. Okay. There. So, you know, in the US, everything is insurance based. So the indication for most of these mixed procedures, primary open angle glaucoma. So if you don't have a diagnosis of open angle glaucoma, the insurance company is not going to pay you for an eye stent or for an hydrus. However, the goniotomy, which is the hook blade, and the GAD procedure, it's a separate code, and they don't care what type of diagnosis it is. So what you tend to do is, I do a lot of goniotomy in my chronic angle closure glaucoma patients. They come to you with a very shallow AC, some PAS on the angle, the pressure is high. The nerve is really not really bad. You know, the 0.5 nerve, they have one arcuate defect. They do really well taking the lens out, getting intraocular lens implant and opening up the angle nasally. A lot of patients do really well and you can avoid a trabeculectomy in a vast majority of these patients.
I don't know, we were having a discussion on the same things, but many of our surgeons have not found some such gratifying results. The angles tend to close up again,
So what I found is I've been doing angle surgery for 15 years now. I started with a trabectrum, in 2007. And I've seen the whole array as I progressed through. And I think postoperative management is really important for as anything else in glaucoma surgery. It's not that you can do the surgery and leave the patient alone, because these patients tend to have blood in the anterior chamber. They, for some reason, angle surgery patients tend to have a steroid response postoperatively. Okay, a large majority of patients have a steroid response. And like I alluded to, I use pilocarpine for 3 weeks, 1% pilocarpine twice a day for 3 weeks. It keeps the iris out of the cleft. I think that's very key and important. Patients complain of brow ache, but you kind of try and persist them. Even though the eye is inflamed the first day, there's a lot of blood in the anterior chamber, I don't hesitate putting pilocarpine on. And I think that's very key to keep them on for 3 weeks. So I typically see them day one, week one, depending on the pressure. If the pressure goes up at week one, I'll put them back on dorzolamide, timolol, or some kind of aqueous suppressant for a little bit. They come back at 3 weeks, I check the cleft on gonioscopy at that point. I see what's going on. At 3 weeks, if the pressure is good, I start tapering the steroid off and I start taking off the pilocarpine. If you start seeing very little anterior chamber inflammation and the pressure is going up a little bit, take away your steroid, start withdrawing your steroid back. If the patient could afford it, I actually use Lotomax as my primary steroid for these patients, even after cataract surgery. Obviously, that's a problem here. A lot of patients can't afford it because, again, it's all insurance-based. So we land up using prednisone, which is a generic, and sometimes you see a fair response. So I think, at least in my success rate, and I can see, Cyril presented the angle closure data, and I would very much agree with some of the data in my practice. It's my go-to procedure to reduce intraocular pressure. I use the other implants just purely to get them off meds. If patient has pressure of 30 and a cataract, I'd rather do a cataract and strip the meshwork rather than putting an implant in the eye.
Fair enough. Pradeep, what is your comment?
Hi, Arvind.
Hi. I and Pradeep have a very long history. I don't know if you know. You've seen my disasters as well. Thank you. So he knows where I am.
But wonderful. It was a beautiful talk, Arvind. And I enjoyed thoroughly. I learned a lot from your talk. It is very, very good talk from the perspective of the students. Familiar with all the things in your armamentarium to surgically manage the glaucoma patients. But the problem with us as a clinician is that, in India, there is a very high intraocular pressure at the presentation, and you always target low intraocular pressure. That is the indication for the surgery for us. Mm-hmm. There is a learning curve. There is a steep learning curve, I feel, the more so, these things are not available easily and pretty expensive. But still, I know that eye stent is coming into India. The Kahoog dual blade is there in India. Zen is trying to come into India for quite some time, but still they have not got the approval from the FDA. But obviously, sooner or later, they will come. So there will be some options available with us. I don't know that what will be the utility in our clinical practice of these procedures. But certainly, you know, go long back when you came with us in Jalna, and at that time, FACO was not so popular, and we always used to talk that there is a steep learning curve and it's very expensive, it will not survive in India. Now everyone is doing the FACO. So similarly, you know, I see a great future of these procedures, but there will be, you know, it will take more time rather than a short time to be popular in India. But yes, we are looking forward. I have not yet practiced any of these procedures. I intend to, but I don't know.
So, you know, my take on this is India is probably the largest market for any global investment. At 300 million population. Come on, where are you going to find 300 million with a large? So I'm not, no doubt that these companies are going to start pushing their implants into India. There's absolutely no doubt. You're going to see a plethora. Obviously, you have the haves and the have-nots, and some are going to have it. But I think the issue with glaucoma is in any country is patients expect success rates are very high. They're paying for the insurance. And we have the same problem, you know, because some things work in some eyes and some things don't work in some eyes in glaucoma. And that's what the truth is. And sometimes you just have to mentally prepare them for that. As far as the Zen is concerned, I think once the pressure flow hits the market, I think the Zen is going to die a death. That's my prediction. Because the pressure flow is a very elegant implant. It's actually a little bit more rigid. It's made from cardiac cath materials, a fin ray implant. It's very easy to do. It's going to replace trabeculectomy in a vast majority of patients. I think you still have some issues where the tenons goes and clogs the little end of the tube, and that's always the problem. And I think some patients, you're going to have to needle and move the tenons away from there. It's a clamp. But I think it's going to speed up, especially in India, where, you know, it's such advanced glaucoma. You're doing like 10 trabeculectomies a day, maybe, if you're a busy glaucoma practice. I think you can do 10 pressure flows in no time. You know, it's just opening up conjunctiva, making a pocket, just flicking it in, putting it back, injecting mito and sending it away. So I think I would look forward to that. And I think Centrum should do a good job of bringing it to the market. And the problem with the Zen, it's really flimsy. It's very fragile. It's very flimsy. It tends to bend. You know, there are hooks in the tenons as you put it inside. So we're still playing with it. We have figured out over the last 3 years how best to use it. I actually remember in 2015, I did my first cases, and Rangaraj from Pondicherry was actually in my operating room. He came and watched me struggle for the first 10 cases, actually, as I was doing it. Ab interno, we still laugh about it, actually, at that point.
It's made of porcine.
Moved away. Sorry?
It's made of porcine.
No. It's made of porcine collagen. It's just collagen. And it's very brittle. It's very brittle. You have to handle it very, very carefully.
Very malleable.
It breaks off. It's 6 millimeters. So I know Allergan makes it and they're going to push it, but I don't see it. I think once the pressure flow comes into the market, it's going to die a death. That's the impression of most glaucoma specialists right now.
So as far as CyPass causes,
Vanita, you have questions?
Why CyPass causes any this endothelial damage?
So that's a good question, right? So I think I mentioned in my talk, I have about 30 patients that use CyPass in my practice. Everybody's cornea is doing great. You know, it'll be 5-7 years. I've sent them, they've got endothelial cell counts, but I've had nobody who needed a DSEC or, you know, endothelial decompensation. So we wonder where that data came from, and we feel that these implants are going to come back to the market with a refractory glaucoma indication rather than a primary open angle glaucoma, mild to moderate. And that's how it'll come back to the market. Vanita, sorry, I interrupted you.
So what I'm saying was, you know, if the time at which tubes were actually given approval, the respective regulatory approvals, had it been in this day and age, they would not get approvals, because placing it in the AC, they tend to cause more endothelial loss dropout than any of these procedures. I mean, I obviously don't know about the CyPass, and I don't know the circumstances about it. I just feel that, you know, the regulations are a lot stricter, and perhaps that's the reason why it happens. So, you know, because we were at Zen, let me just ask a few questions. I know, you know, by the way you were talking about it, I feel that you're not that keen on Zens anymore. But all these blip producing procedures then, or preservflow. Would you still do it temporally? Would you raise a bleb temporal, or would you go superior?
I go superior or supranasal, I'll be very honest to you, because I'm still saving my territory for future.
Yeah, okay.
You know, because my tube is going to go supratemporal. I think, you know, as a glaucoma surgeon, you guard your territory really well. You want every bit of conjunctiva for the future.
Absolutely.
So almost to my Zens, actually, I go supranasal right now. You know, I have a small cohort of patients. It's funny. I have, you know, I see a lot of refractory glaucoma, and I have these patients who come in with a tube in the eye. And when I first came out of fellowship 15, 20 years ago, I used to do a lot of second tubes. You know, that's what they taught me at Bascom Palmer. I did a lot of second tubes. Let me tell you, my second tube rate has gone down drastically. And the reason is because of the cornea. You put a second tube in the eye, the cornea fails. And Pratip is, you know, shaking his head because his wife does the transplant for him right there. So he knows, right? So the reason is, you know, so I've actually split in a Zen supranasally in some of these patients. Mm-hmm. And believe me, like in glaucoma, we don't know what works, right? I have this black lady, monocular, bad glaucoma, African-American, came in with the tube, everything. I slid a Zen supranasally. Her pressure is 10 on one medication, a year and a half, 2 years out. Go figure. I don't know why. So she's an N of one or N of two, you know, whatever. And maybe, you know, I just placed it right and the mitomycin worked and she responded. And that's what really happened. So, you know, every piece of territory, you know, if she needs something, she's going to need one more procedure before she, you know, goes down and probably put a tube inferiorly at some point.
Right. Yeah. I mean, funny you say about two tubes. Now, we don't have the choice here. And as you heard from Dr. Pratip himself, that iStent inject has got the approvals now. And, you know, the handful of glaucoma specialists around the country who are going to contribute to the real world data. But, you know, because obviously there is none available in Indian eyes. So far. So, but that apart, what I'm saying is, you know, I just did a second tube today because of lack of, you know, these devices, what you could use or, and yes, he's an, you know, an only eyed patient. His one tube failed. You know, I did his, counts, endothelial counts. Endothelial count is half that of his other eye, which is blind. So had to place the tube in the sulcus, and the previous tube also I resited in the sulcus. So, you know, you just have to adapt to what you have on the day and, you know, hope for the best, really. Right, there's another question where, you know, I think most people have this confusion is, you know, and myself inclusive, I think I do remember talking to you in one of the GSIs, maybe perhaps the Mumbai one, which is now 7 years ago, is, you know, are the MIGs competing with TRAB? Are we actually looking at a replacement for TRAB, or are we simply just finding solutions earlier on in the disease rather than thinking about later?
I think it's the latter. I think it's definitely the latter. Trabeculectomy is not going anywhere. You know, trabeculectomy is not going anywhere. It's still our mainstay procedure. You know, I think it's still the procedure to go through. But you have a vast majority of mild to moderate glaucoma patients. And Marlene Monster, one of my other mentors, says it very well. There's glaucoma light and there's glaucoma heavy. And 30% of glaucoma patients are light. 30 to 35% are light. And these patients are probably on drops for a long time. And it's just that you can reduce the burden of medications in the long run. And that's purely where these devices work. Okay, they really don't help. Now, a certain percentage of those glaucoma light will progress to glaucoma heavy along the way, depending on the genetic makeup and, you know, how the gene is different. And obviously then you still have the conjunctiva viable for them to go ahead and get something else done down the way. Okay, so that's the way I look. I think you're looking at tackling the disease earlier. I think we all know that with medication managers, compliance issues, patients don't use meds, you know, you have surface issues long-term. So I think what these aiming to do is get a little bit better control earlier on in the disease. So hopefully when they do progress, you can manage the disease better later on. But what, you know, I think, you know, you're really not curing the problem of advanced glaucoma, which we see in India along with late presentation. You know, that I see late presentation here every day.
Believe me, I saw a guy yesterday. He had been to his optometrist every year a mile, already count fingers in one eye, 20, 30 in the other eye. Myopic nerve really cupped out. So we see that here. People have been trained. I see that in my practice every day, which like you see. So that doesn't go away. I think those kind of patients are still going to need filtering surgery. I think, you know, maybe somebody will come up with something better at some point, a better suprachoroidal route so you get bulk flow and avoid hypotony. Don't know. Yeah.
And also I found it a little bit, what shall I say, surprising when you said that you do use pilocarpine even when there is a lot of inflammation in the eye, because I have tried, and you know, now goniosynucleosis seems to have fallen on the wayside, but you know, doing goniosynucleosis in angle closures, as you know, we have many more angle closures that require surgery, and then you want to prise the iris away from the trabecular meshwork. How, you know, whether that actually results in the trabecular meshwork being more functional, more efficient, we don't know. But you know, the study that has come out of Singapore, and actually Professor Tin Ong was one of our guests, and he very categorically said that they have now published that it really does not make that much of a difference, which I thought was you know, a very, very honest of him. But you know, doing it, what I'm trying to say is that in my experience, using pilocarpine in this already very inflamed eye is just make things so much worse, because what you really want is them to be not stuck down, and you know, you want them to be to be dilated rather than constricted.
I just use it BID. It's a 1% concentration, so I'm not doing it QID, number one. So I think the pupil's still in play a little bit, so that helps a little bit. But obviously a certain percent of patients don't tolerate it, and if they don't tolerate it, I don't lead it on. It's a little voodoo, I get it, but I think it's just helped me in the long run. I don't see as much PAS into my clefts over a period of time. And I don't think there's any study that's actually looked at it conclusively to say which way we'll go. I'm just giving you some clinical pearls from my practice. And I tend to use it, and I, you know, some of the new doctors have come along and tried to push it to that. And they've actually taken it along the way too. And, you know, obviously they must have seen some benefits to that.
I mean, there obviously is difference between, you know, lighter colored irides and not so light.
Sure, absolutely.
There is absolutely no doubt.
Oh, no doubt about it. Oh, we have a fair share of brown irises, Hispanic patients. I have a huge Indian practice in this metroplex. Don't worry, they come and find you. So, yeah.
Right. Really where MIGS in India is concerned, we are sort of practicing more more cost-effective versions like the suture GATT.
Right, exactly.
Or instead of KDB, really using BANG, using bent needle, avinternal goniectomy. And the not so cheap options, you know, endocyclophotocoagulation and trabectome. There are a few pockets where it is being practiced. I'm seeing a lot of, you know, good result with endocyclophotocoagulation and angle closure.
Absolutely.
Yeah, there we are. Any final words, maybe? I think we've overstepped a few minutes here.
Thank you very much. I think, Neil, that was so wonderfully done, and we are really grateful for clarifying so many procedures for the students, and like Prateep said, for us also. Thank you so much.
Pleasure to have you guys. Thank you. Okay.
Thank you, Arvind. Thank you.
And good morning for him.
yeah, I got to go back and see 20 patients.
Yeah, go ahead. Enjoy yourself.
we can discuss now. Yeah, after a busy day. Bye. Thanks very much. Yeah. And just for the postgraduates, I just want to say there is actually, this wasn't the last glaucoma lecture. There is one coming up next week on Wednesday on cyclodestructive procedures. And that is going to be delivered by Dr. Murli Ariga. Unfortunately, I will not be able to be there because I have a prior commitment for another webinar. So I'd like to say bye-bye to all of you. I really loved being a moderator, and hope this has been in some way useful to all of you. Thank you. Good night.
Bye. Good night, Anita. Take care.